Success and Failure in Implementation. There's been a great deal of research looking at success and failure in the implementation of innovation projects. And although that research has covered many different sectors, many different countries, firms of different sizes, and products and services, the same messages keep coming through. It's important to start with a good innovation, a superior product or service offering, of course. So all that work we do in looking and then selecting and then building a strong business model where we're clear about the value proposition, that's not wasted. That helps to make a superior, defensible product or service offering. But it's also important to build in the voice of the customer, that market side that we've seen is so important in a strong business model, but to build in the views and input from other key stakeholders. But the evidence is also clear. Organizations which have a systematic process for progressing projects, project management, are more likely to succeed. And linked to that, the idea of stage gates, of close monitoring and evaluation at key stages throughout the project, and the discipline to, if necessary, stop the project or to change direction radically. It's also valuable to have an agile philosophy, speeding things up through fast learning, extensive experimentation. Another key factor is the early involvement of those key players. One of the things about innovation is that for all that the simplest, it's going to require the input of many different people coming from many different parts of the organization, different pieces of the knowledge jigsaw puzzle. So it's very important to bring them in as early as possible. For example, if we're designing a product, it's crazy to do all our design work and then hand it over to production, asking them to make it. Far more sensible is to invite them in from the very early stages so that they can tell us some of the input from their world of manufacturing, the things that they can and can't do, the things that might help improve our overall design, what's sometimes called design for manufacture. And as these players start to work together, so it's important not to do things in a sequential fashion. One of the big lessons learned way back in the 1980s was that accelerating product development depended on moving from what might have been a little like a relay race in the Olympics, where one team would pass the baton to the next who would then run with it. Instead of that kind of model, it became more of a rugby team approach. Everybody aiming for the final goal, but all running alongside each other at the same time. So the idea of overlapping, parallel working becomes another key feature in success. As we've already seen, project management is important and the ways in which that's enabled. So finding the appropriate structures, if the project is of major significance, it might require a dedicated team. If it's a smaller project, we might be able to manage with a matrix, a part-time team, and sometimes the projects can be carried out within the day-to-day work of a team. But above all, innovation projects are going to depend on effective project teams and effective management. Just like in a football team, it's not simply assembling 11 people. Teams are made, not born. And a great deal of research has been done, and we'll come back to this, looking at the factors that make for effective teams. But many of those teams are going to have to work across different knowledge boundaries. They'll come from different parts of the organization, perhaps even from outside the organization. So learning to work with diversity, learning to work as a cross-functional team is another key success factor. And closely linked to that is making sure there are effective ways of resolving conflicts. Conflict can be very healthy. In businesses like filmmaking or the theatre, that kind of early argument about creative differences is healthy, as long as those differences are resolved in time for the final product or service to be delivered well. And the good news is that there are now many advanced support tools available to help with innovation project implementation. The chance to do extensive simulation involving different people asking questions about what if. And there are now a wide range of tools to help visualize and indeed to create rapid prototypes. But perhaps one of the most important themes that comes through repeatedly is that organizations, if they're smart, try and build their capability for managing implementation over time. They conduct post-project reviews, they extract the learning. What can we do better or differently next time? Now, it's important also to reflect that it's not just about doing one or two things well. This picture is typical of the results of studies of success across large groups of organizations trying to implement projects. And don't worry about the detail, just look at the fact that there are many boxes and there are interrelationships between the two. This is essentially what we've learned about successful implementation. We need to manage a bit like an orchestra, different players, different themes across the whole piece. And it's as true for services as it is for products. Again, this is a busy slide, but the key point here is to look at those very many 36 different features which all affect service innovation. This comes from, again, a piece of research looking at a number of service innovations, and it's developed a tool where organizations can assess their profile. How good are they at managing these factors? Now, in all of this thinking about products and services, we might be forgiven for thinking, what about processes? Process innovation is essentially about product or service offerings, but targeted for an internal market. And they, as all our innovations have done, move along the spectrum from do better, incremental innovation, through to do different, radical innovation. For example, we might be improving or making improvements to procedures, very small changes, right through to bringing in some major new equipment or carrying out a radical reorganization. This is innovation, but the market in question is inside our organization. And for this reason, it's sometimes not called innovation. Very often it's called change management. But in effect, it's the same thing. How do we introduce, how do we implement innovation successfully? And perhaps not surprisingly, the same sorts of factors are involved. Very important is to involve people as early as possible, and not least, to get out their concerns and anxieties, to get them to understand what is coming and that they could be a part of. And finding ways to co-create, working closely, continuing to interact with users, because the evidence is that users will then take some ownership of what is being introduced and add their input to make it a better design. This can be helped, of course, by running pilots, using prototypes, and having an agile approach, being prepared to fail, pivot, change direction. But as before, project management, effective leadership, appropriate structures, and effective teams make a huge difference. So let's summarize very briefly where we've been in this film. Success in innovation implementation is not an accident. Organizations might get lucky once, but repeating the trick is going to require a systematic approach. And amongst the key factors which emerge through study after study are the following. The nature of the innovation itself, having a superior, robust product or service. Planning and project management. Staged strategic reviews. Having an element of flexibility, agility in development. Having effective project organization in terms of structure, team, and leadership. Having early, widespread, and continuing involvement. And building capability over time, using post-project reviews and trying to capture the learning for the next time.